mean, the greatest group in the world. That was a really great concert, that. Tremendous, absolutely.
I think it's a thing we always thought we would do. We would come back to Sydney and meet the Lord Mayor. Because we always played on the steps. And we always said, well, one day we're going to go up the stairs.
Was everything a man could want to do? I could never see tomorrow, but I was never told about the sorrows. Where is the sun that shone on my head? Sun in my life, it is dead, it is dead. Where is the light that would play in my street? And where are the friends I could meet, I could meet? Where are the girls that left far behind? The space and the space of the girls of my mind.
Spicks and Specks was out, and it went to number one, and we were on the boat when we found out. Yeah. And like people saying, oh, we must book the Bee Gees, and meanwhile, we're on the boat in the middle of the Indian Ocean. You know, on our way to back home.
It is dead, it is dead. The sticks and the sticks are the girls on my mind.
Righto, chaps, let's have a check. Flaps?
Check.
Check.
Rudder, right, strike. RPM, Morris.
Okay. Right. Clearance to take off over.
We thought going home was great. Let's just go home and see how we do there, you know. And we went home. And
this group met us at the ship. Not actually met us, just they were hanging around.
They were past the railway tracks.
No, they slept. They said they slept on the railway tracks, so good luck to us. You know, they said there were so many groups in England to turn right round and go back. Fixed and Specs was released too late in England. We weren't there in time to promote the actual record itself, so it couldn't have taken off at the time.
Yet our first made record in England, which was New York Man Disaster, went all over Europe and England.
Because we were there, you have to be there to promote it.
Within the week we arrived there, a guy called Robert Stigwood phoned us up from NEMS and he said, could we, you know, see you and so forth, and we didn't know what, you know, we only had £200 between eight people.
They were on the same team, weren't they?
That's right. Yes. Oh, my old man's a dustman, he wears a dustman that. He wears God-blinding trousers and he lives in a council flat. Now if you see a dustman all looking all pale and sad, don't kick him in the dustbin, it might be my old
talent you can have, but without the initiative and the willpower and the experience and volleys.
The basic thing is that a lot of people come back saying, well, it's because we're Australian, we didn't make it. And this is absolutely untrue, because every time we've heard of somebody that's come from Australia, their record is always played. And if it doesn't go, it doesn't go. But if it does, it does, you know.
Morning, Mr. Sunshine, you brighten the outside.
when we broke up, we were children. We were children when we lived here, and we were children when we broke up.
You have a brother?
Yeah.
Oh, did you fight?
Never.
Oh, come on.
No.
Come on.
You must have had one little kid in a rock war or something.
Well, I bet there's no one in this room that hasn't fought with a relative. Ours was made public, that was the difference.
So we all went our separate ways. I was the first on March 1969 to depart the wave, and brought out a record called Saved by the Bell.
Phillips, Robert Stigwood, David Shaw, myself and Morris are the five major shareholders in that company.
Because at that time Robin had been separated from us and he was with Vic Lewis, which is
this
the
was after
names.
Robin left, remember?
And he now has shares in the company, but at that time he was all signed up to Vic Lewis.
What caused their breakup, actually?
On the whole, became musically compatible, and now that we know the goal is the same, is the same.
It's the same.
It's exactly the same.
Musical incompatibility, that was the whole thing.
And when you think about it, we were together.
Pardon?
How did you get it back together?
Brothers. That was it. I mean, you can't avoid each other all your lives. It's
we were together
argument.
Like a month before our manager knew it.
Why do it alone when you can do it much better and happier together?
All the days, all the nights. Where would I be without my wife?
Fidelity, you know, it sounded just like the record with the orchestra on that.
Oh, great music.
Oh, horrible.
I thought it was terrific.
They're mature and they're musical a lot better.
You can really sit and appreciate and just listen to the words they're saying and appreciate the emotion that they're trying to get across to the audience.
We believe in what we're doing because what we're writing and what we're singing is what we were doing when we were children. And it's not musical knowledge, it's not something we've been taught. We just grew up doing it.
Some people make a fortune, and others own a mint. But my old man don't earn much. In fact, he's flipping skint.
Oh, my old man's a dustman. He wears a dustman's hat. He wears called blimey trousers and he lives in a council flat. He looks a proper nana. His great big old male boots. He has a job to pull them up and he calls them baby roots. Now some folks get tips for Christmas, and some of them forget. So when he picks their bins up, he spills some on the step. Well, one old man got nasty, and to the council wrote. Next time my old man read mouth there, he thumped him up the throat.
Whatever we're doing it naturally.
Right.
Well, you can't say, oh yeah, we're going to have that idea, because that idea will come when it's up, when the time is right.
You deal with people.
We just feel our way along.
How are you recording the sound of my foot? Devilish thing. I'll take it off if you like it. I'm on the muffler. Yeah. Now, we are writing a lot more together than we were when we were together before the split.
Our music has never been directed towards drugs.
Never.
Never. Someone told us once that there was a track called Every Christian Lion-Hearted Man Will Show You. And I was in Paris with a friend of mine, and we were just staying in the hotel, and we were having something to eat, and this guy I met there, I knew in England, came up to me and he said, "Hey man, what are you on? You're tripping, aren't you? You're
tea, man, tea.
Every Christian Lion-Hearted
More wow, tea, quick, friend. More tea, quickly. Plenty of tea, tons of it.
Would you like a drink? You know, that's what I'm on.
No, really. No, please. When we first started writing, like New York Mining Disaster, these things, nobody was on drugs as far as we knew. We just arrived in England, it was green as grass.
God knows how many lectures like that. He doesn't even drink.
Paul McCartney never touched anything.
Paul McCartney never had a drug.
He was the last one to take LSD, and then he publicised it.
There's not one that we can say, "Oh, that's the best one we've done yet." You know, because every time we do a thing, we go, "Oh, that's great." You know, we must get that one out. You know, and then all of a sudden you go, "Well, we can write something better." You know, we haven't come to the day yet when we said we've written the greatest song that we think that we've written. I don't think we'd write any more songs. Now, Robin is basically sad. He writes very sad songs, and Barry writes a very romantic. No, I'm an avid fan of Tony Joe White's type of feel. Yeah. Swamp music I love, you know. Mm. And
you're talking down there once, just to get the idea.
Yeah, I live in a swamp for 3 months, you know, just to write Lay It On Me.
Don't you drink with me, cause you know that I'm a loser. And I'm proud of that fact, you can plainly see. Going from town to town, and now I tell you I've been around. It's a low-down credit, never did any good. It's a low-down credit, who never did.
Once I sweated it out in that swamp.
Yeah.
And Robin spent a month in the monastery just so he could write his sad songs. And Barry lived with Engelbert Humperdinck for a year. Yeah, I mean, there's one song that Barry wrote himself on the new LP, which is just unbelievable. It's the best song I think he's written this year. It's unbelievable. It's called The Greatest Man in the World. Thank you so much for the Golden Spoon Award.
I want to hear it more and more.
What's it again?
No. Yeah. No.
G?
No, A?
What key are you in?
D.
Well, then it's F sharp major. Yeah.
Take me to heaven, my love is stronger than the wall. I'll climb it till I fall, so I can hear you call. Your love be the greatest man in the world. 'Cause I can say I got the greatest girl. Be the greatest man in the world. 'Cause I can say I got the greatest girl. Before I saw your face,
strings coming here.
I never saw a dream like that before. I wanna see it more and more. Take me to heaven, my love is stronger than the wall. I'll climb it till I fall, so I can hear you call. Your love be the greatest man in the world. Cause I can say I got the greatest girl. Be the greatest man in the world. 'Cause I can say I got the greatest girl.
This afternoon to Slade Logan, fellas, with a small presentation to make. Going back 5 years ago when I last spoke with the boys as they left Melbourne to promote Spicks and Specks, they assured me they'd be back with a lot more hit records, and they've proven this well and truly. When Barry was here last year, we were able to present him with the gold record for sales of 10,000 copies, and I'm very pleased to say the album has now achieved a second gold record for 20,000 copies, and I'm very happy indeed to have the boys here to be able to present each of them with a gold record.
What can you say? That's except to thank everybody involved. That's marvellous. Everybody.
Excuse me, but I've got a Hollies on mine.
Do you always have Bill Shepherd doing your arrangements?
We work together on the arrangements.
So those he does on his own, we don't use.
This is vital that we do that, because Bill always asks us what we want or where we want it, and we usually tell him where to put it.
Bill Shepherd does everything beautifully. He's a beautiful arranger.
When he works with Mick Jagger, it's terrible.
Oh, yeah.
But he's great with the Bee Gees.
Marvellous at the bottom. No, what are you
saying? No, we call it the sweeping Shepherd strings.
Have you ever heard Mick Jagger singing Play With Fire with
like
his strings? You are playing with fire if you're playing with Mick, they say in the trade.
Give me the moon.
The trade is a very tricky trade.
You think that I don't even need a single word I say.
Shut the door, please. Shut the door and start again.
Right.
Okay.
The BG's, my lord, man.
You think that I don't.
We did a concert here once.
Have
short pants and that.
It's only words, and words are all I have to take your heart away.
And well, I have an opportunity of hearing him.
Oh, I hope you could come along.
Yes, we'll
do the show for you.
Well, that'd be very nice. Lord Minister, I'll get much time to get a pop concert, but so maybe we might be able to take it anyhow.
It's only words, and words are all I have to take your heart away.
I have a production company in England, which I produce Richard Harris, my wife, and Tintin. And I decided instead of buying a nice house somewhere in the, like, Switzerland or France or something, I'd put the money into a studio.
Or with the sleeping bag in the studio. Eventually he will produce children, is it not so?
Well, it could be rumoured.
Because if you produce children, is it not a production company?
We had reports of your single stuff that you wrote and everything coming, but we didn't hear it. Is it still in the can, or is it possible?
Well, obviously, yeah. We all did separate things.
We all did solo LPs, solo singles. And Barry and myself and Robin's all new singles were solo. We buggered up because somebody could push the button in the computer. But when we did get back together again, we decided to leave all the stuff we'd done solo out.
Oh, my heart. Don't believe that you have left me. I keep telling myself that it's true. I can get over anything you want.
Record sales on the whole are bottom, rock bottom.
Tom Jones hasn't had a hit there since.
Tom Jones' last one, anybody's last one.
Engelbert,
you still have your top 50, whatever you like, but the same sales don't apply anymore. That's what's happened, is the decline of record sales, probably because of too many groups, too many artists, 200,000 groups working in England, and maybe a fifth are successful. So you have, you know, nearly 200,000 groups out of work. The focal point is the United States. Four British recording artists. Every concert we did, the audiences were absolutely marvellous.
There were reports of half-full hall in some place that you played.
Rubbish. The only reports, and I will state, the only hall that was half-full was the one which was hit by a damn earthquake in California. And if anybody wants to go out of their house and risk another one to watch the Bee Gees, I would say don't.
Do you think that this movement, this rock liberation thing, do you think it would catch on here?
It cost a lot of money to put a show on.
Well, it's very American.
I can't see how people here would think like that.
I got a phone call saying something about, oh, it's a little matter of marijuana in your room.
Feet!
My legs went like jelly. And I said, who is this? And he said, it's the manager, and before the police arrive, I'd like to have a word with you. And I'm freaking out my hair, so I go downstairs with Ray, our PA, and we go downstairs and he said, let me do the talking because it's a load of rubbish, you know. And the manager had been out for an hour for lunch and he wasn't due back till 4 and it was an outside.
Same people.
We went out for a couple of couch.
There was this red Indian type of guy with a thing around his head and long black hair sort of thing.
Say, mate, please be with you, my friend.
The hotel forwarder knocking on the door and saying, has Barry got $100? You know. And Linda's going sort of, just a minute, and sort of this six Indians stood outside the door, you know.
And Jefferson,
an American.
Well, yeah.
God knows what's going to happen with this next American.
His audience reaction, which has been good, surprised you?
They've been marvellous.
They've been fantastic.
The people are a lot warmer. Not just toward us, they are in general. I'm through with romance. I'm through with love. I'm through with counting the stars above. Maybe that's the reason why I'm so free. My loving baby is so for me. Bye-bye love, bye-bye happiness. Hello loneliness, think I'm gonna cry.
Automatic
faders.
Yeah. Very
done out. I can't describe it. It was very polished.
It gives you more of a feeling when you're in it.
I should have gone for longer.
Oh, they're gorgeous, that's why.
Oh.
Did I ever? Well, I haven't got a ticket, but I would if I could. Yeah. Oh, well, the group, they're fantastic. I just think they function beautifully as a group.
Definitely got the biggest reception, because I come to most of their concerts, and this one's got the biggest reception that I've ever been to.
We'll always keep coming back. Maybe that's what it is.
Why is that? Is it some sort of renewal?
Yeah, I think so. We love Australia. It's partly our home, and England's partly our home. So, you know, most of our life we've lived here. So we're partly Australians.
In the event of something happening to me, there is something I would like you all to see. It's just a photograph of someone that I knew.
Bee Gees, my lord, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
Bridgeford.
How do you do? Very nice to meet you.
The boy's father, Mr. Gibb.
Ah, how do you do?
My love, man.
Nice to see you. You're all very welcome to the town hall.
Thank you. Thank you.
Looking forward to your visit here.
Oh, very, very much.
Well, I hope you have a very successful tour. I'm sure you will.
Thank you very much.
You've got quite a reputation now, haven't you?
Well, we hope so. As long as it's a good one.
You keep up now, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, I have an opportunity of hearing you.
Oh, I hope you could come along.
Yes.
You know, good. Because we do the show for you.
Yeah, well, that'd be very nice. Lord Minister, I don't get much time to go to pop concerts, but so maybe we might be able to take it in. Anyhow, I wish you all the very best.
Thank you very much. Very
and,
nice to meet you.
Don't stay away too long
you
when
much.
You go away again. Come back. Goodbye.
We'll be back.
That was Cape Coat.
That was Cape Coat.
Thank you very much.
Well, nice
thank
to meet you.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Bye-bye.
Seems like you've been, the stamp of respectability has been put on the BGs now you've met the Lord Mayor.
Yes, definitely so.
She's
giving
God.
It's a great honour. Great honour. Because we always, I think it's a thing we always thought we would do. We'll come back to Sydney and meet the Lord Mayor. Because we always played on the steps. And we always said, well, one day we're going to go up the stairs.
Now I found it. That the world is round, and of course it rains every day.
What caused that breakup, actually?
Musical incompatibility. That was the whole thing.
And when you think about it, we were together.
Pardon? How did you get it back together again?
Brothers. That was it. I mean, you can't avoid each other all your lives. It's
we were together like a month before our manager knew it.
No, the idea was when we broke up, we were children. We were children and we lived here and we were children when we broke up.
When I was small and Christmas trees were tall, we used to laugh while others used to play.
Now that the group have reformed again, would you ever consider making another solo record?
No, because the reason I said that bluntly was because the goal that the three brothers were aiming for was compatibility, it was the same. And why do it alone when you can do it much better and happier together? And we have done so.
I can think of younger days when living for my life was everything a man could want to do. I could never see tomorrow, but I was never told about the sorrows. How can you mend a broken heart? How can you stop the rain from falling down? How can you stop the sun from shining? What makes the world go round?
Well, we believe in what we write. We believe in what we're doing because what we're writing and what we're singing is what we were doing when we were children. And it's not musical knowledge. It's not something we've been taught. We just grew up doing it. And if you're doing anything else, it becomes, I don't know what the word is, but whatever we're doing it naturally. And that's
the
thing.
We've never gone into a studio to do something
tried.
On purpose. We've just gone in there and said, okay, what are we going to do?
You're not getting into a heavier scene at
no.
all?
No.
Someone said to us...
5 minutes.
Okay.
You've got to get away.
We said, you know, like somebody said,
and a cup of tea,
American yeah. press thing said that we were so overground, we were underground. You know, we were... And you know, it was incredible because, like, the stuff we've done, like the audiences we had in America, we're like all sitting there smoking.
You're
going to
get a cup of tea?
Yeah. Marijuana.
How
the audience going, oh,
your music
groovy,
is directed towards these smokers.
We're going, yeah, really.
Our music has never been directed towards drugs. Never.
But Lennon has admitted that he's taken thousands of
trips.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah.
No, so surely his music must have been influenced by.
Well, I was fortunate to be with
but how
the
can you tell what influences the brain?
And
how do you know?
He doesn't even drink.
Paul McCartney it. Never touched anything.
Paul McCartney never had a drug.
He was the last one to take LSD, and then he publicized it.
Mm. Someone told us once that there was a track called Every Christian Lion-Hearted Man Will Show You. And I was in Paris with a friend of mine, and we were just staying in the hotel, and we were having something to eat, and this guy I met there, I knew in England, came up to me and he said, "Hey, man, what are you on? You're tripping, aren't you? You're
tea, man, tea. When we first started writing, like New York Mining Disaster, these things, there was nobody was on drugs as far as we knew. We just arrived in England, it was green as grass.
Like that?
Why have you brought such a large group of musicians with you?
Well, why do we bring such a large group? We have an obligation to an audience, they are our records, and if they appreciate our records and buy our records, then we are obligated to present the same sound.
You always travel with, say, 10 musicians, as you have out here?
They always want to go. 15. We're always travelling, they're always travelling with us.
No, there's a loophole
minimum
in the contract.
Minimum of 16.
No, the loop in the contract is that they travel with us. We don't travel with them.
It's irrelevant, BO as well. Boeing, you know, Ben. Now, you see, the thing is, we have an obligation to those who appreciate our records and those who are our audience. And if they recognize it and appreciate our music, then it's only our obligation to our audience to bring to them our sound that we have made. Well, then they are, shut up, and they bargain for them. If not, then they're still hearing us singing. It's certainly not covered up by our voices.
You can keep on going, boy.
You're doing very well. Do you always have
Have a shot of this microphone. Let's take a shot of
that. That's really it. No,
come on.
That nearly rubs.
Look at that microphone. Look at that.
This is Mrs. May.
Let's look at that microphone. And the man who does the sound.
Hang on, this is not a technical hitch.
Do you always have Bill Shepherd doing your arranging for you? Do any of you ever do any of your own arrangements?
Only we do a lot of our arrangements along with Bill. We work together on the arrangements. So those he does on his own, we don't use.
Bill Shepherd does everything beautifully. He's a beautiful arranger.
When he works with Mick Jagger, it's terrible.
Oh, yeah.
But he's great with the Bee Gees.
Marvellous. No,
we call it the sweeping Shepherd strings.
Have you ever heard Mick Jagger singing Play With Fire with his strings?
Anymore.
You are playing with fire if you're playing with Mick, they say in the trade.
Give me the moon.
Just don't you ever feel overwhelmed by this whole Gibb family?
Give to the Gibbs.
No, but it's quite satisfying working with some talented
people. Don't you feel your voice is playing straight man to them?
Give to the Gibbs.
Don't you feel you're playing straight man to them sometimes or all the time?
No, not really. I like, you know, it's they're good. They like good jokes and it's good laugh and
we speak
I
well
enjoy
of
it.
And
he says that with a straight face.
Yeah.
You know, it's not.
No, everything's great.
How long have you been with the Bee Gees?
I bet it's 4 months, 5 months.
And no regrets at all?
No regrets.
Give him an LP!
It's only words, and words are all I have to take your heart away. Telling me I must go home.
My next guests have had quite a career, most successful, as singers and songwriters, and as well as their own hit recordings, their compositions have been recorded by people like Frank Sinatra, Elvis Presley, Mandy Williams, Glenn Campbell, Tom Jones, hundreds of others. They're currently on a concert tour in the United States, and they're appearing this Thursday night at Santa Monica Civic Auditorium, and they're going to be hosting NBC's Midnight Special 1 week from Friday here on NBC. This is their latest album called Life in a Tin Can. It's always a great kick to have them on the show. Would you welcome the Bee Gees? Fellas.
Thank you. of a sudden I saw a new morning. Locked up, I wanna be free. Out in the courtyard and over the wall, and my friends are waiting for me.
16 people are waiting to get me, hoping to take me out. My bones, they are aching. My soul must weather the storm. I must run till my back it is breaking. Desperately I must keep on.
16 people are waiting to get me, hoping to take me outside.
Take a break. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Those are two fine numbers. Are those both from the current album?
No. One is. The second one we did.
Yeah.
Which is also the new single. And the other one is on the newest album, which will be released about mid-July.
You fellows compose all of your...
Yes,
that's right. All of your stuff, don't you? Now, I got to get the name. I know it's Maurice, Robin, and Barry.
Robin,
now, which...
Morris...
Robin and Morris and Barry. You do a good deal of the
Robin and me take a major part in that,
mm-hmm.
in the writing. Morris helps a lot with the melody line and rhythm instruments. He plays a lot of instruments.
Yeah.
He plays piano and bass.
You were mentioning this, there's so many groups around, and you guys have given up more or less playing what you call the stadium large places because you felt that you weren't giving... the audience really what they came to see because you lost all that intimacy.
No, it's not that. What the biggest thing is that you get a stadium of 15,000 people
mm-hmm.
and you get about 3,000 really listening.
Right.
And the rest are out of touch because they're not really in communication
right.
with you on the because you are just a soldier on the stage not a soldier necessarily,
yeah,
but a person on the stage in which they are not, they are only listening vaguely because they can hardly hear you, they can hardly see you, so they tend to carry on with their own activities and,
yeah,
and start talking with the other people.
You're really cute.
But you also must enjoy it more when you have that rapport with the audience, because if you're playing to somebody vaguely sitting 100 yards away...
You can't get him off the stage.
Really?
The end of every show.
I love an audience.
He mobs the audience. He's the only one I've ever seen do it.
No, it's not.
You guys have had fantastic success, and well-deserved. How did it all start? Your family? Did it come from a musical background?
I was 9, and Maurice and Robin were 6 when we started.
Mm-hmm.
And we started doing matinee theatres. You know, where you work after a film or before a film. We used to get a shilling a time.
That's fine.
Things haven't changed very much.
10 cents.
Things have changed a lot.
We get
shilling
2 shillings
at a time. What was the first big breakthrough? Because you came into popularity at a time when there were hundreds and hundreds of groups.
We got our first big break in Australia in 1962 with the Chubby Checker show.
Hi, this is Chubby Checker. Remember me?
Just think, guys, in 30 years you'll be selling those records on television. Remember?
No, thank you.
You'll be coming out, "Where are the Bee Gees? Remember this one?" They say, "Where do old record stars go when they die?" Now you know where you're going.
Yeah, like Mill.
You'll be nostalgia time, you know, in 20 years.
Well, it'll be like Mills Brothers.
Heaven forbid.
Right.
It won't be so bad.
Yeah. Are there any more youngsters in the family?
Small one. Yeah. A younger brother, who's 15, and... sister, who's older than you.
He didn't want you to say how old he was.
He didn't? Oh, God, because, you see, when he goes on tours with us, he wants to get all the girls, you know.
Uh-huh.
And now I've blown it. So tell him
he's only 15?
Well, he tells him he's 18.
Does he also hope to join in the group or get his own...
Yeah, eventually it may happen, you know, because Andy is writing and he's singing, you know. So he's playing a guitar, so there's a chance in the future he'll develop and we'll be able to get a four-part harmony nicely.
Right. Now, not all of you are married.
Yes, we're
all married. You're all married?
Yeah.
So, do you have the... Well, I don't know whether it's a problem or not. But when you were single, you know, a lot of the groups had the groupies. Who followed them around.
It's a pleasant problem.
Our road managers get them.
They get them before we do.
Do you still have the fanaticism that a lot of the groups had in the early days, the almost uncontrollable...
We have a very... They're amazing because they listen, which is a good thing. You don't have a lot of screamers. They listen very much so during the songs, and they show their enthusiasm afterwards. And it's very nice then. They go mad, absolutely mad, after the song.
Because for a while you'd go to a concert and nobody could hear anybody from the opening number.
Yeah.
We had that, you know, but some of the fans that have grown up with us that come and see us...
They like to listen.
Right. You know, that's good.
And we like that too.
Mm. They show their appreciation after the show, you know, which has been incredible on this tour. It's been unbelievable from New York right through.
Which of the... Do they carry on like this all the time?
No, only on this show.
Only on the show.
The atmosphere of the show. Do you miss the rapport you have with an audience live rather than television?
We love it, because then when you go on stage and you're actually working in front of, say, 6,000 people or something, depends on what, you know, place you're working, you're actually seeing the people appreciate what they liked on the record. You're actually seeing them.
We like to go out and make friends with the audience. That's the whole thing.
Oh, he goes with the audience, shake hands with everybody. And...
No,
he
doesn't.
But we like to do that. We like to make friends. Then you have a wrap-up all the way through the show.
Right.
You know, nobody shouts out or heckles you.
Yeah, that's great.
You get to know them.
It's great.
All right, so we're going to take a short break here, and we're coming right back. Okay. Stay with us. Back now. Somebody mentioned something about an acoustical number that you can do just casually here.
Is that one tuned up?
Well, it's tuned up my way.
All right.
Play it your way.
Now, you said it's tuned up your way. What do you mean?
Well,
You tune?
I play guitar. Entirely different.
You play bass? You play bass guitar mainly, right?
Yeah, he plays bass.
He plays bass.
It's the same old bass. He plays bass guitar.
And you tune it? In other words, you don't normally tune it as a six-string guitar?
I tune it a six-string, but I tune to an open D chord.
Yeah.
Well, you know, sometimes he my tunes. Brother turns one of them down. I don't know which one it is. And, yeah, you've done it again, haven't you?
Yeah. That's about as far as I've progressed on the guitar anyway, is really getting it in tune. No, we're getting the other
tuning.
Guitar.
Oh, yes, we'll say. Play. It's all right, like no more tuning.
All right.
Okay. We got one. You got one.
We got one.
Here we go.
Copies now, quickly.
Okay, we're going to do a song called Massachusetts.
Massachusetts.
I'm going back to Massachusetts. Something's telling me I must go home.
Short naps are wonderful when you have to lay out, aren't they?
That's why you see I stay in the background now.
That's funny.
I wear these suits so everyone can see me.
I should mention before we have to say goodnight. Well, I'll do it when we come back. We're going to take a short break. We're not coming back? I want to mention Thursday night show when we'll talk about Jonathan Livingston Seagull. Fellas, I thank you very much. Have a good go at Santa Monica. Hope you come back and see us. Bob, thank you, and we'll talk about that picture someday. Tomorrow night, Charlton Heston, Rex Reed, UB Blake, and Richard Bach. Thank you. Good night.
This program was pre-recorded.
Thank you, and good morning. We're the Bee Gees. I'm Morris.
And I'm Robin.
And I'm Barry.
We're very pleased to be the first actual group
to host the Midnight Special.
And joining this morning are so many great artists that we want to get right to it.
So our first guest is truly one of the kings of rock and roll, Mr. Jerry
Lee
Lewis.
Yay!
Thank you.
Money don't get everything, that's true. What it don't get, I can't use. So give me money.
morning, and welcome to the Midnight Special. It's great to be back here again. Fantastic. My God, excuse me. We've got a special treat for you this morning. Very special treat. We'd like to introduce to you, on television, for the very first time... Thank you.
What?
For the very first time, Morris and his famous dummy... Morris's famous dummy. Morris... You're crazy, man. Morris's famous dummy, Donnie.
Here he is, our first guest, Wilson Pickett.
I want y'all with me because we're gonna do a little soul hootenanny here, see? Me and the Bee Gees, see? Hey Jude, don't make it bad. Make a sad song, make it better. Remember to let her in your heart. Then you can start to make it better. Take a soul, brother. Make it better. Now one more thing. So let it out, let it in. Hey, you began. You waited for someone to perform it.
like you never before. That's the best band in the land. My honey, man, come on along, come on along. Let me take you by the hand. Up to the man, up to the man. Who's the leader of the band? Now if you want to hear, that's what he ever played. Come on and hit, come on and hit. Alexander's right time band. Come on here, come on here. Alexander's right time band. Come on here is the best band in the land. We'll hear you play with the call like you never heard before. That's the best band in the land. My honey, man. Come on along, come on along. Let me take you by the hand. Up to the man who's the leader of the band. Now if you want to hear, that's one he'll never play. Come on here, come on here.
Before we say goodbye, we really want to thank all the fantastic guests. Thank you, you're marvelous. And it was a real thrill hosting a midnight special again. It was really fantastic.
That's right. Thank you for having us here. You've been a really great audience, and we hope to host it.
To anyone under 30, my next guests really need no introductions. They became superstars in the pop recording field with hits like Lonely Days and To Love Somebody, and no other group has had as many of its songs recorded successfully by top name performers. Here from England, and please welcome them, please, are the Bee Gees.
Thank you.
you meet everyone backstage, I hope?
Yes, we did. Yes.
That's nice. You know John, you know Melba and Sam.
Hello, Julian.
How are you? Gentlemen, be seated.
Right, you're supposed to sit there, remember?
Is he supposed to sit there? Yes. Why?
Just what I was told.
Does he do the talking? You do the talking?
No, no. It's a little fallacy, that.
I'd like for my viewers to know your names.
I'm Barry.
Barry?
That's Morris.
And Morris? I'm Robin. And I'm Robin.
Robert?
Yes, excuse
Robin.
Me.
Robin or Robin?
Robin.
Robin? Robin.
Yes.
Yeah. You've been here a very short time, I'm told, this trip.
Just a few days. Mm-hmm. Just a few days. We did two shows in Pittsburgh, one last night. One on, what night was it?
Friday.
We don't know what day it is.
Really? I mean, the jet lag has caught up to you, right?
It's the energy crisis.
Yes.
Exhaustion.
Speaking of energy crisis, yeah, what about England now? What are things like there?
What about England?
Well, I was talking, was that one of your, was that gentleman I spoke to backstage?
Well, that was Daddy. A dad. Yes.
Who's Daddy?
That's our father.
Oh, your father?
Yeah, that's our father. Yes.
You're...
Get off. Okay.
Your brothers.
Yes, we're all three brothers.
Yeah, we're twins. Then that would be your father, yeah.
That stands to reason, yeah.
Your father was saying that the gasoline thing, and he said petrol, it's kind of settled down now. People can get gas or petrol in England. Is that true?
Well, it's a lot better than it is here. It's dreadful. You know, here to get petrol, you're going through so much trouble. Where we went through this trouble maybe a month ago when it was pretty bad, but... Most of this can be blamed on the papers and the newspapers over there. They panic everybody, you know.
You think people are overreacting to it everywhere?
Well, I don't think the public were in England. You know, in the papers in England, it says, you know, trouble. You know, that's it. They just print trouble. And everybody goes, huh? Wow. Oh, carry on with what you're doing.
Carry on. I love that.
You know,
I love
and
that.
The English, you know, well, it seems pretty much the same way here. There's a lot of humor about it. People
it's
take it very much in their stride, you know.
The British people always, I don't know what it is, every time during a crisis, they always have a great, you know, sense, they always go through it with a lot of humor.
Do programs about it and send it up.
It brings people together, it does. You have a common thing happening.
Oh, yeah. Except, you know, we don't want to go too politically, but...
And it was like the Depression in the 1930s, not that.
I don't remember that.
It was like the Depression. I mean, the best thing that ever happened to England, in the 19, although it's a horrible thing to say, was the war, because it... pulled people together and it made everybody forget about the economy.
Common cause.
this may bring the common people together in either America or England, but politically, the main trouble is amongst the different parties in politics.
Yes, but are you absolutely sure?
Yes,
but
if there is a unity there, there may be an even better unity amongst the people themselves.
So,
there's too much fighting. We waste power in the Houses of Parliament with Labour Party arguing with the Tories. About, you know, the Tories make a point about something, the Labour kill themselves laughing out loud.
Mm-hmm.
This is not good.
And you, Morris, started to laugh, I think.
Yeah, Morris is conservative.
He's got to laugh.
Well, how did they... Oh, I'll ask you this in a moment. We have to break right now. We'll be right back, right after this commercial. You were telling me something, Barry, which I think you should relate to our viewers. It's very interesting about the Washington correspondent who came to England.
That's right.
A couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, well, this was a television man, a television reporter, who went over to England to see what the situation was like, because he was totally under the impression that things were really bad over there and that we were under martial law, that there were troops at the airport, holding the airport. Why, I don't know. And there wasn't a car on the road. And he came over there with that impression. And we're driving normally. We get a full gas tank, full tank of gas.
I'd rather have the first one. Yes.
But that's the case.
Yeah.
We're not under that situation at all. And now, he was under the impression that we were.
Now, how did the press in England handle our Watergate situation?
Well, that's about the only thing we hear about in England. You know, we don't hear so much about your gas problems or any other problems. We just hear about Watergate and that man.
Actually, since the gas problems, we hear very little about Watergate in this country.
Yeah, so we've noticed.
Maybe that's what brought upon the gas problems. Who knows? What are you going to sing? I love when somebody's lip-syncing a record, especially get the drummer's eye, and you know, when they're just pretending they're playing, go like this. Can you keep it down? And they look at you like you're crazy, you know. You're not a real drummer? Oh, it says I'm not a real drummer. How about that? What is the next song? Is it a composition of yours?
The next song is a record we had a long time ago out, called Massachusetts.
Oh, that's a nice place. Will you sing it for us? The Bee Gees. Few music lovers haven't been touched by my next guests in one way or another. They are truly a rock world institution. And here doing their hit single from their latest album called Main Course are the Bee Gees.
Jive talking, you love till you die, then all that jive talking. in your eye.
To believe, is that true that you guys are celebrating your 20th anniversary?
It's our 20th year on the stage as a group.
How old are you, Barry?
I'm 28. I'm the twins
here,
me and him.
And it's your 20th year as a group?
Well, I was 8.
They were 5.
You were precocious.
Same year as Bill Haley.
Yes.
Dad wanted us to go to work at 5 because we weren't. Earning any money in depression.
Yes. What are you doing to celebrate the 20th anniversary?
I think the nicest thing is that we've got a record in the charts. I think that's the best way to celebrate any anniversary.
It sure is.
Yeah.
I don't want to talk our way through your next number because we're a little pressed for time. Can we get you to do another number for us?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
The Bee Gees once again.
Somehow I feel
some poor friend, singing them love songs, singing them straight to a heart song, blaming it all on the night some poor friend.
E.G.